Hello, ghouls and goblins. It's your friendly tour guide, Elevated Chillz, back again with another scary story to tell in the dark. This scary story is known by Bloody Bones. Bloody Bones is a ghost story for kids about a boogeyman who has no skin on his face or body and kidnaps naughty children. It is sometimes known as Rawhead and Bloody Bones. A version of the story has appeared in even more short and shivery and favorite scary stories of American children. The ghost story of Bloody Bones began as a nursery rhyme for children in Ireland and Scotland hundreds of years ago. Tommy Rawhead and Bloody Bones were two boogeymen who would kidnap children who misbehaved. At first, they haunted wells, ponds, and other bodies of water, but then they moved inside the house and lived under the sinks and drains. The rhyme went something like this. Rawhead and Bloody Bones steal naughty children from their homes, takes them to his dirty den, and then they are never seen again. There was no real story associated with it. If children were acting up, their parents would just say, "Watch out, or Bloody Bones will come and get you." Bloody Bones was a dreadful, crouching creature with blood running down his face. He sat waiting on a pile of raw bones, the bones of children who told lies or said bad words. As time progressed, it turned into a simple story about a ghostly skeleton that creeps up the stairs saying, "I'm on the first step, I'm on the second step." This is almost the same story as the story of the antique doll. Later, the tale migrated to America and became an American African folk tale about a mean little boy named Little 8 John who never listened to his mother. He squashed frogs, climbed trees, and sat backwards on chairs. His mother told him to stop doing all of this or Bloody Bones would come and get him. But of course, he didn't pay any attention to his mother because he knew everything after all. One night, Bloody Bones came and ate Little 8 John, leaving just a bloody stain on the kitchen table. The next morning, his mother was cleaning the house and she wiped up the stain that was the end of Little 8 John. Eventually, the story migrated to the Ozarks and became an Appalachian folktale about an old witch who brings a dead hog back to life. Way back in the Ozark Mountains, nestled in a hollow deep within the woods, there was a little old house. In that old house, there lived an ugly, scrawny old woman with a hooked nose and crossed eyes. She had a reputation for being the best conjuring woman in the immediate area. Her house was full of herbs and roots and bottles filled with conjuring medicine. The walls were lined with strange books brimming with magical spells. She had only one friend, a mean, tough, old razorback hog that ran wild around her place. The hog rooted through her garbage and ate all of her roots, potions, and leftover spells. Some folks say it ate so much that it could walk upright and talk just like a man. That's what some folks say, but of course, I've never seen it for myself. One fellow claimed he'd been seen the pig sitting in the rocker on old Betty's porch, chattering away to her while she stewed up some potions in the kitchen, but everyone discounted that story on the account of the fellow who told it was a little too fond of the moonshine. Rawhead was the name old Betty gave the razorback, referring maybe to the way the ugly creature looked a bit like some of the dead pigs come butchering time down in hog scowled Hollow. The Razorback didn't mind the funny name. Rawhead kept following old Betty around her little cabin and rooting up the kitchen leftovers. He'd even walk to town with her, and she came to the local merchant to sell her her home remedies. Well, folks in town got so used to seeing Rawhead and old Betty around the town that it looked mighty strange one day around hog driving time when old Betty came to the Mercilant without him. "Where's Rawhead?" the owner asked as he accepted her basket full of home remedy potions. The liquid in the bottle swished in an agitated manner as old Betty said, "I ain't seen him around today, and I'm mighty worried. You seen him here in town?" "Nobody seen him in town today. They would have told me if they did," the merchant owner said. "We'll keep a lookout for you, most definitely." "That's mighty kind of you. If you see him, tell him to come home immediately," old Betty said. The merchant owner nodded agreement as he handed over her weekly pay. Old Betty fussed to herself all the way home. It wasn't like Rawhead to just disappear out of nowhere, especially not the day they went into town. The man at the merchant always saved the best scraps for the mean old Razorback, and Rawhead never missed a visit. When the old conjuring woman got home, she mixed up a portion and poured it into a flat plate. "Where'd that hole got to?" she asked the liquid. It clouded over, and then a series of pictures formed. First, old Betty saw the good-for-nothing hunter that lived on the next ridge sneaking around the forest, rounding up Razorback hogs that didn't belong to him. One of the hogs was Rawhead. Then she saw him taking the hogs down to the Hog Scout Hollow, where folks from the next town were slaughtering their Razorbacks. Then she saw her hog, Rawhead, slaughtered with the rest of the pigs and hung up for gutting. The final picture in the liquid was the pile of bloody bones that had once been her hog, and his scraped clean head lying with the other hog's heads in a pile. Old Betty was infuriated by the death of her only friend. It was murder to her, plain and simple. Everyone in three counties knew that Rawhead was her friend, and that lazy, old, good-for-nothing, hog-stealing hunter on the ridge was going to pay for slaughtering her precious animal. Now, old Betty tried to practice white conjuring most of the time, but she knew the dark secrets, too. She pulled out an old secret book her granny had given her and turned to the very last page. She lit several candles and put them around the plate containing the liquid of Rawhead and his bloody bones. Then she began to chant, "Rawhead and bloody bones, Rawhead and bloody bones." The light from the windows disappeared as if the sun had been snuffed out like a candle. Dark clouds billowed into the clearing where old Betty's cabin stood, and the howl of dark spirits could be heard in the wind that pummeled the treetops. "Rawhead and bloody bones, Rawhead and bloody bones." Betty continued the chant until a bolt of silver lightning left the plate and streaked out directly through the window, heading in the direction of the Hog Scowled Hollow. When the silver light struck Rawhead's severed head, which was piled on the hunter's wagon with the other hog heads, it tumbled to the ground and rolled until it was touching the bloody bones that had once inhabited its body. As the hunter's wagon rumbled away towards the ridge where he lived, the enchanted Rawhead called out, "Bloody bones, get up and dance." Immediately, the bloody bones reassembled themselves into the skeleton of a razor hog walking upright, as Rawhead had often done when he was alone with old Betty. The head hopped on top of his skeleton, and Raw went searching through the woods for weapons to use against the hunter. He borrowed the sharp teeth of a dying panther, the claws of a long dead bear, and the tail from a rotting raccoon, and put them over his skinned head and bloody bones. Then Rawhead headed up to track towards the ridge, looking for the hunter who had slaughtered him. Rawhead slipped past the thief on the road and slid into the barn where the hunter kept his horse and wagon. Rawhead climbed on into the loft and waited for the hunter to come home. It was dusk when the hunter drove into the barn and unhitched his horse. The horse snorted in fear, sensing the presence of Rawhead in the loft, wondering what was disturbing his usually calm horse. The hunter looked around and saw a huge pair of eyes staring down at him from the loft. The hunter frowned, thinking it was one of the local kids fooling him in his barn. "Land o' Goshen, what have you got those big eyes for?" he snapped, thinking that kids were trying to scare him with some crazy mask. "To see your grave," Rawhead rumbled softly. The hunter snorted irritably and put his horse into the stall. "Very funny," the hunter said. When he came out of the stall, he saw Rawhead had crept forward a bit further. Now, his luminous yellow eyes and his bear claws could barely be seen. "Land o' Goshen, what have you got those big claws for?" he snapped. "You look ridiculous." "To dig your grave," Rawhead intoned softly, his voice a deep rumble that raised the hairs on the back of the hunter's neck. He stirred uneasily, not sure how the kid in his loft could have made such a scary sound, and if it really was a kid. Feeling a little spooked, he hurried to the door and let himself out of the barn. Rawhead slipped out of the loft and climbed down the side of the barn behind him. With nary a rustle to reveal his presence, Rawhead raced through the trees and up the path to a large moonlight rock. He hid in the shadow of the huge stone so that only things showing were his gleaming yellow eyes, his bear claws, and his raccoon tail. When the hunter came level with the rock on the side of the path, he gave a startled yelp. Staring at Rawhead, he gasped, "You nearly knocked the heart right out of me, you crazy kid. Land o' Goshen, what have you got that crazy tail for?" "To sweep your grave," Rawhead boomed, his enchanted voice echoing through the woods, getting louder and louder with each echo. The hunter took his heels and ran for his cabin. He raced past the old well house, past the woodpile, over the rotting fence, and into his yard. But Rawhead was faster. When the hunter reached his porch, Rawhead leaped from the shadow and loomed above him. The hunter stared into terror up at Rawhead's gleaming yellow eyes, piercing the hunter's skull. His bloody bone skeleton with its long bear claws, sweeping raccoon's tail, and his gleaming sharp panther teeth. "And what have you got those big teeth for?" he gasped desperately, stumbling backwards from the terrible figure before him. "To eat you up like you wanted to eat me," Rawhead roared, descending upon the good-for-nothing hunter. The murdering thief gave one long scream in the moonlight. Then there was silence and the sounds of crunching and bones cracking. Nothing more was ever seen or heard of the lazy hunter who lived on that ridge. His horse also disappeared that night, but sometimes folks would see Rawhead roaming through the forest in the company of his friend Old Betty, and once a month, on the night of a full moon, Rawhead would ride the hunter's horse through town, wearing the old man's blue overalls over his bloody bones with a hole cut out for his raccoon tail. In his bloody bear-clawed hands, he carried his raw razorback hog's head, lifting it high against the full moon for everyone to see. To be fair, you shouldn't go killing a witch's pet.